And we are live. Hello and welcome. Please note that this webinar will be recorded and posted online. I will do a brief spiel and do a rundown of the application and the guidelines, and then open up the questions for all of you. As we're doing this, I think you guys should see who's talking for a moment. Hi, this is me. My name is Lorena Ramirez-Lopez. I am the project manager for the Memory Lab Network. I'm here with my colleagues, Lauren Algee, project supervisor for the Memory Lab Network, and Nick Kerelchuk, project director for the Memory Lab Network. I wanted to make sure I said his name right. So thank you for attending this info session on how to apply for the Memory Lab Network. We appreciate your prerogative in partnering with us to expand the Memory Lab model and to help bridge the gap of knowledge and resources when it comes to digital preservation. So a bit of background on the project. DC Public Library's Memory Lab was first established in 2014-2015 by a year-long National Digital Stewardship Residency, NDSR, resulting in a do-it-yourself program consisting of three main components: a digitization lab with equipment for digitizing video and audio and scanning photographs, documents, and slides, digital preservation classes and curricula and training for the public, and a website with equipment and workflow instructions and resources for long-term storage and preservation of analog and digital archival materials. This model was meant to be replicated, so in 2016, DCPL partnered with the Public Library Association to expand the Memory Lab model across the United States. The reason why we're here. The Institute of Museum and Library Services awarded DCPL and PLA a national leadership grant to build the Memory Lab Digital Preservation Program at 7 public libraries. Through this application process, these seven public libraries will be identified as project partners and will spend 1 year creating personal archiving stations and programs to their communities following the DCPL Memory Lab model. The Memory Lab Network will provide financial support on setting up these models, as well as training in an in-depth boot camp in April where travel and housing will be provided by us. Now to talk about the application. That's why you're all here. I am going to share my screen, so please excuse me for one moment. Sharing screen. Can you guys see my screen? Sweet. So, hopefully you're familiar with this website. It provides the basic information of the project, what the Memory Lab is, who can apply. So this is what the Memory Lab is, what the network is, and who can apply. So we are defining public libraries according to the Certified Public Library Administrator Program, which also includes and recognizes tribal libraries. So a public library, you can read it here, is an entity that is established under state enabling laws or regulators to serve a community with at least one of the following: an organized collection of printed or other library materials, paid staff, established schedule in which services of the staff are available to the public. Don't move my mouth.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. The facilities necessary to support such a collection, staff, and schedule, and support a whole or part of public funds. So how to apply? The application process is open from October 15th to December 15th, 2017. So we are at the halfway point right now with this webinar. We try to keep this application process as simple as possible. So in order to apply, your institution needs to complete the online Memory Lab Network partner application form, which you can click right here. This application requires at least 5 steps. So one, filling out the application form, and we can actually see the step-by-step process. So if you click step-by-step instructions, you'll get that. So there's more about the opportunities. There's 5 steps. Filling out the Google form itself is one step. A letter of commitment from a director of your institution. Can you see it? Oh, You got it? Oh. Sorry for any web delay, or maybe this is on our part. a letter of commitment from a director of your institution. This is to make sure that the entire library organization will be there supporting you and maintaining the memory lab rather than it just being a single person's project. Two staff members from your library to be point leaders of the memory lab at your institution. They must be able to dedicate a combined 10 hours a week to the memory lab. How you divvy up those hours will be settled amongst yourselves. And these staff members must be able to come out to Washington, D.C. in April for in-depth boot camp. Step four would also include uploading the resumes of the staff members. Please note that all documents will only be shared internally among the Memory Lab Network staff, which is Lauren, Nick, and myself, as well as our advisory board. None of this information will be shared, and if that should change, we would obviously contact you beforehand. And you need to answer 5 short essay questions about your library, and one of them is actually a radio button, so that's even easier. Let's look at the guidelines, which I have right here, and then we'll look at the Google Forms. So our contact information is everywhere. You can email us, call us at 202-727-2274, or attend an information session like this one every Tuesday until the week of December 15th. Looking over the timeline, so there's more information about this opportunity, what the Memory Lab Network is, the project timeline. So looking over this timeline, the partner's involvement in this project will be a little bit over 1 year, beginning in April 2018, when the staff members come to Washington, D.C. for the boot camp. Then these two staff members will dedicate a combined 10 hours weekly to build the lab and to contribute to the project. There are two phases for the partners, the actual building of the memory lab and the evaluation and sharing. Partners will build a digitization lab, attend virtual cohort check-in meetings every 2 weeks, most likely on Wednesdays, attend monthly webinar featuring presentations and Q&As with specialists who have yet to be determined. During this project, we ask that you collect statistics on the program attendees and lab users, number of hours, types of media transferred and requested, common issues and feedback. This is so we can improve the memory lab model to be adaptable in different environments. You will also plan to teach digital preservation classes for the public. Digital preservation doesn't just end with digitizing your audiovisual materials. These classes will help with informing the library patron on how to care for the materials while helping you develop a more long-term management and sustainability plan. As the project manager, which is me, I will check in biweekly with the partners. Organize the monthly webinars you'll need to attend, assist the selection and purchasing of lab equipment, and general training and mentoring. The evaluation and sharing phase requires partners to evaluate the memory lab model at their libraries, attend at least one local outreach event to share the project regionally, contribute to the white paper, and participate in interview and host a site visit for when the project manager, me again, comes to visit. So here's who can apply to partner. Let's move down. So the need for the memory lab, what the memory lab model is, this is application, how to apply, which is this Google form, which we'll click in a minute. So who will select the partners? Partners will be selected by the project advisory board. I will first do a preliminary check to make sure all the requirements were done, so submitting the letter of commitment, our resumes, etc. Then it will be reviewed by Memory Lab staff. Please note that this project will prioritize the participation of public libraries that identify either as tribal or rural. The reason being is that these opportunities are unfortunately few and in between for libraries, so we want to give the chance for people who the libraries usually won't have the opportunity. And since we have arrived by the step-by-step application instructions, we're going to do, I'll switch over to the Google form, and we'll actually try to fill it out ourselves. So this is the Google form. I'll give a second for it to load up. So it currently requires your Google account. Can you guys see the Google form? Okay, so we're gonna sign in. Live demos are every presenter's worst nightmare. So name of institution, we'll just do a small little rundown. So you will put the actual title of your institution. So I will put, for example, DC Public Library. Location of your institution. I am currently at Penn Center. And it's Washington, D.C. Applicant name, Lorena Ramirez-Lopez. Applicant job title, your job title within your institution. So I am the project manager. Applicant email address. So I'm not going to put the Google, so the Google emails do not get recorded. I will put my work email so we can contact us.
Gmail.
The you sign in with Gmail, but it doesn't get recorded. Our phone number, which was 202-727-2274. Identification of primary. So I can be the person who is filling out this application and be one of the staff members if necessary. So I'm going to put my name, and then let's have Lauren be my second person. Now, add files. We're going to add our resumes. You need to upload PDFs only. So we actually select. I actually have our resumes right here. They're both PDFs. I just named them so I can recognize them. Upload. Uploading. Perfect. So statement of interest, institutional activities, highlight your library's experience with programming, community engagement, and any complementary programs around the local and personal history, digital literacy, or preservation access. So here if, for example, say we have Linda account. You would ideally write it as an essay form, but for time and I want to get to be able to talk to you guys, I'm just going to bullet it for now. But ideally, you would do it as an essay form. So like we have Linda accounts for library patrons. We have labs, that's called the Fab Lab, Studio Lab, and Memory Lab. We have digital classes on how to use computers, et cetera, et cetera. Or, yeah. And here, institution type, so this is your little checkbox. We are neither rural or tribal, so we're other, and we'll put public library. Describe your library, so describe the community your library serves, including characteristics such as population size and distribution, racial and ethnic distribution, age range, and interest. This is where Lauren can help me out a little bit. How will we describe our library?
We're an urban library.
Urban library.
Serving diverse populations.
Serving diverse. 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 And you're like, oh, our library could be a good partner. This is where you would kind of describe and highlight the greatness of your library.
And any unique characteristics.
So community needs, outline your library's mission and community needs as they relate to this project. How would your community benefit from the creation of a memory lab and digitization preservation program? So, for example, BCPL, we have one, but there's a lot of people who can't go to our Northeast Center. So it's like the memory lab, so our memory lab is in high demand, and we want or would like to expand to other communities, or you can say, so that's because we currently have a memory lab. This basically highlights how the community would benefit and enjoy. Or
yeah, there's demand for local history programming, genealogy, digital creative classes.
I don't think they can hear you, so.
I know, you can repeat
them. No, you can't.
So we're particularly interested in if institutions are already doing programming that relates to this, which is noted above, but also if there's been a demand, if there's a community need, if there's really interesting things going on in your community that you would like to encourage your community to document. You know, if there's been, for example, if you're in Flint, Michigan, you might say it's really important for people to be able to preserve their personal histories because there's really important history going on there right now, that the community is in need for, you know, all the reasons that we're all familiar with. So anything like that that's just interesting about your community, that's identifying your community, any requests you've already had around assisting people in preserving their personal histories or community histories would be good to put here.
So we write all that. organizational investment, outline how your library can invest in the project. This does not necessarily mean financial. This can just say that we will have staffing or we will be able to provide
that we'll partner with another organization.
Partner with another organization.
Help sustain it and help sustain programming. Anyways, you can already say that you can sustain a program after, you know, this year of investment with CCPL happens.
So say like while we can try to budget, we have staffing for the next 5 years or et cetera. And then your organizational commitment. So just basically a little disclaimer that you're willing to partner with us and accept and recognize the responsibilities, and so the letter of commitment should be created and signed by an upper level administration and should state that the library's support for creating and sustaining the memory lab. So if on our application form there's an example of how you can write the letter of commitment, I currently have it here. So just basically your organization's address, the basic contact information to the Memory Lab Network Committee, so introduce yourself and your institution, and say that, state your library's interest in being accepted as a partner and accepting responsibilities. So here you would just, it also has to be a PDF. And so you would just drag and drop it, upload. Perfect. So we went through the whole application, hit submit. And says, thank you for applying to be a partner. Here's our more information. If you want to see your previous responses, you can look at them again. And if you need it or like you realize you want to change it a little bit, you can edit it as well. And so that's it. I'm going to unshare my screen. Stop sharing. And I'm next. And we're going to try to open it up without having a really high squeaky sound. Let's see. I think it might be my phone. So. No, that's my phone. Because I called him. So give us 2 seconds. I wonder if I connect audio. Switching audio. Can you all still hear me? I switched my audio. So, can you guys hear me?
We got kicked out.
You got kicked out?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I can hear you.
You can still hear me. Okay. Audio connection. Perfect. Participant. Okay. On mute call. So, I can hear myself. And I can hear people typing. So this is your opportunity. Either you can write in the Q&A box. And we got one application, one question right now. If our application isn't accepted, so this is Lauren, and this is Nick. We're going to not share our thing anymore, actually.
So if you aren't accepted this year, the question is, will we offer this again in 2019? At this point, we can't say for certain. We are thinking about potentially applying for another round of funding from IMLS, but for right now, we just have the funding for the 1 year. Stay tuned, but that's the end of it. Can you say more about that question about why you're asking about the application questions changing? Does the guide not match up with that? An issue you're seeing, David?
Would it be possible to set up a mobile lab that could travel to multiple library locations? Yes. What are the dates for the boot camp? It is tentatively April 15th to the 20th. That if it's subject to change, we definitely will let the partners know. But it's a tentative April 16th to the 20th.
A little bit more about the question about the, could we have a mobile lab? We are going to provide a certain pocket of money to each participant, so we're not stating that everyone has to spend that money in the same way. As far as equipment goes, it's definitely not going to be enough money to buy a truck and set up a lab. However, if your institution would be interested in buying a truck, that would be fine. We can also talk about ways to purchase equipment that will be more mobile, so you could just move the equipment itself from place to place. We're definitely going to tailor what equipment people end up with to what their needs and desires are, whether that's being mobile or stationary or focusing on certain formats, et cetera.
So the commitment letter at one point, so in the instructions, I will change it to reflect to say upper level management. It has to be someone upper level management. It's usually a director, but it doesn't, I guess, have to be. Yeah. It's someone.
If you have a public services director, if you have a head of a special collections department, if you, it has to be a managerial position. If we're not specifying specifically who that has to be.
So thank you for that. I will change that wording so it can reflect that it does say upper level management to avoid any confusion.
Anything we haven't covered? Any questions?
Just to confirm, use a personal Gmail. You could, some work organizations have Gmail as their work address. Please note that your Gmail address will not be recorded. That's why in the application we have a valid email address that we can contact you, because we do not record. I currently am trying to change that. We also had changed their form policy. So if you don't want to use a Gmail account, we can try to email me, and I can try sending you the link so it can probably hopefully open. You can try troubleshooting it, but your Gmail account will not be talk more about
10 hour per week
time commitment.
The 10 hour per week time commitment. So we're thinking that that's a combined 10 hours between the two staff members, and it may not always be 10 hours a week, but we just want to make sure that there's enough time for the staff to commit to doing the program planning that will be needed, to be doing the evaluation, to be setting up the equipment, troubleshooting. There is a lot of troubleshooting required in getting this up and running, and maintenance as it goes.
It's not like you just set it up and it runs itself. So that's part of why we said 10 hours. Again, that's sort of a rough estimate. But we just wanted to make sure that institutions knew what they were getting into when they signed up for this, that it wasn't just going to be, you know, something that they spend a few hours on one week and then it's a brand new service that, that takes care of it. That also includes time to attend the check-ins with Lorena, the project manager, and the webinars, which will be adding to their your knowledge about digital preservation, troubleshooting, ideas for programs, and your overall participation in the project. So, yeah, if you could please mute yourself, there is some strange background noise that I don't think is entirely coming from us. So if you have your mic on, please mute it.
What type of equipment does the grant cover?
So the funding is for equipment and also for programming. It's primarily going to go to equipment. We will probably give recommendations to each institution that every institution will end up with at least scanning and VHS conversion, because those are our two most in-demand services. And from talking to other institutions, it's what they've seen as well in what they've created for the public. That said, again, it will be tailored to your community needs. It primarily focuses on scanning and on AV digitization. So audio cassettes, different video formats, as well as computers for those stations, some maintenance equipment like cleaning equipment. Let us know if there's anything in particular you're wondering about if it would cover or not. As we said, we do also want you to be doing programming, so if there's anything that can assist in that programming, we can also consider that building that into your budget. Like if you need to create, you know, a big poster foldout, you can take places with you, et cetera. Reel-to-reel is not something we have here. In general, it's a more complicated setup, but if it's something you really want to do, we can probably figure out a way to make that work for your institution. It's going to be a lot harder to make reel-to-reel digitization DIY for the public, because there's just more involved with it than just you know, a cassette tape.
How many large urban library systems do you think you will select for this year's cohort?
We haven't determined a makeup. The advisory board is going to sort of look at everything in context, because we do want it to be a diverse group. So you know, we don't want it to be all large urban libraries. In fact, as Lorena mentioned, we are going to try and prioritize participation by organizations that couldn't do this on their own. But at the same time, we do want at least probably one or two big libraries to round out the cohort. Because again, we want it, you know, we know how this works at DC Public Library, but we don't really know much about how it would work anywhere else. And so part of the idea for the grant is to bring more stations out into the world, but also to be able to evaluate what works across different sizes of institution, different geography, different types of populations, different, you know, levels of funding at the organizational level. So yeah, we're not sure exactly how many urban libraries will be included at this point.
Has the program addressed issues of viruses, et cetera, for digital media people might plug in to our machines? Currently, the only thing that a person would plug in would be their USB drive. And I guess it would also depend on, like, the library group patron. So ideally, yes, your computer should be up to date with software.
Virus scanning software.
A lot of the programs that we would install, help you guys install, is open source and safe. For the digital media people that will come in, they would only be able to insert their USB. And I mean, this is also one of the obstacles and troubleshooting that we need to get more information on.
Yeah, we have not experienced any problems here at DC Public around viruses. Also, when it comes to legacy media, like if somebody brings in a floppy disk, Yeah, and that has an old virus on it. It's unlikely that that would affect mm-hmm. a modern machine. However, we could also talk about, you know, we could install something on your machine like a project called BitCurator or other open source software for working with legacy media that has things like virus scanning in it, as well as being able to identify personal information and other things, indexing.
There's also some IT quirks, I guess you could say, depending upon your institution. We've had to have, when you're originally set up, we had to talk to our IT about letting them know that the computers that would be in the mm-hmm. memory lab would not have our general image and things of that. That kind of locks out patrons from doing certain things. So you will probably have to have individual conversations with your IT departments, letting them know that these are not going to be on the same networks and systems that they're used to.
Right. You would probably try to have this not on a network, you know, library mm-hmm. network drive where it would have access to anything that could be super harmful. Yay, BitCurator. Yeah, we like it too. however, I will say that we don't actually have a lot of use around floppy transfers yet at our lab.
Mostly because people don't realize we are able to do.
I know. It's an area where we need to do more promotion. What's the timeline for notification? End of January, I think, is what we're shooting for.
So if the application is until December 15th, this is where we're kind of doing crunch time, and it's also by the holidays. So it's ideally either the end of the year or early January.
Early January.
Early January. I mean, well, yeah, we're having to work around holiday schedules, but we are hoping to get notifications out as soon in January as we possibly can. So definitely by the end is like our final deadline, but hopefully much sooner than that.
And there's going to be some immediate paperwork for your institution if you were to receive the grant. This is like extremely vital that we receive this information within the first week or two that you get accepted. So just to let you know, for you guys to accept the money, the sub-grants, there has to be some budget paperwork from our side that needs to be filled out. So we're trying to do this quick because you have to get into our system, and that can take up to four to six weeks according to our budget. So
we
want to make sure that we're giving out the grants in a timely manner, and we're also receiving that information quickly.
Question about hosting digital assets online by the partner library, or is it just to provide digital copies to patrons? So when we created our memory lab here, it was very, very important to us that there be no expectation of the library taking those materials, that this was about public information and public knowledge and education around digital preservation. That said, I think that there can be a conduit there to a local history collection if you have one, but that's not the purpose. And I'll also say that here at GCPL, we definitely get in a lot of people transferring things that we would not be interested in adding to our collections. I'd say that's actually most of it. Some of that's because people come from other places. Some of it's because it's, you know, very personal, intimate home movies of school plays and things like that that aren't necessarily fitting within our collection scope. But that said, we've also moved towards doing sort of community scanning events that are related to and build off the technology that we have in place because of the memory lab. So again, I think that that's something that'll depend on the individual library. I think it's very important to at least have some amount of time and space that is dedicated just to letting people care for their own materials outside of any expectations of, you know, it being taken by the library or hosted by the library. But again, that may be something that's actually really in demand from your patrons. We don't know. So again, that's sort of going to be up to you and depend on your location, your library. How much money is the grant award per partner library? So we had a certain bucket written into the original grant. However, you know, we've been using our money up to this point, and we, I think, are actually going to have a little bit more than we thought. So originally what was written in was it was like more than $5,000.
It was more than $5,000. I think what will be interesting, and because of the diverse communities applying, is that there's going to be some certain standard equipment that you're going to get. You know, most people, if not all institutions, will get a VCR, you know, things of that nature. However, your community might have different, is going to definitely going to have different needs from other institutions. So We're going to be spending a lot of money on each institution, but it may differ just because someone might need, someone might be doing more Betamax, let's just say, than another institution, because that's what their community used and that's what they need. So it's not going to be everyone gets a certain set of money, but it will definitely be over 5,000. I just think that we're going to have to, we want to make sure that the community is getting what they need.
And DCPL will be doing the purchasing just because that will streamline things. We don't want you to have to deal with your own procurement departments because we know how hard it is to deal with ours. So we're just going to deal with ours and take care of that for everyone, though it'll be based entirely on what the partner libraries want and select. Additionally, that pocket of money for equipment is totally separate from travel money. We will be paying for the selected staff to come to the boot camp, no matter how much that costs, whether you're in Hawaii, maybe whether you're just up the road in Baltimore, we'll be paying for that travel. So that also will vary from institution to institution. So that's also part of why it's sort of hard to give a hard answer of how much will be awarded to each partner. But I think you'll be happy. I think it's a good amount. Anything else? We're also happy, I mean, you don't have to fit every single question you have into this Q&A right now. We are contactable. Lorena's email is on that Memory Lab Network page on our website.
It's on like everywhere.
As well as our phone number. And, you know, I know questions will arise as you're also filling out the application or as you talk to your administrators. So please, please feel free to contact us. We're here to answer your questions. We want you to apply. We want as many libraries as possible to apply so we can build a really great cohort. We know that you all have, you know, special communities and awesome reasons that we should give you the lab, and we would love to hear what those are.
Is anyone trying to call in to ask a question, or is everyone able to? I'm going to
type in the chat or the Q&A box.
Well, if they can't type in, let me unmute everyone. So you might hear background. This is just so if someone's calling or trying to speak to us, like a spirit.
All right. Well, we'll leave this open for a few more minutes if anything occurs to you. But let's see. The recording of this webinar will be made available. Do we have a time?
Yes,
it'll be on our website, either as a link. I don't know if it'll be embedded there before link out, but it'll be on that same dclibrary.org/memorylabnetwork page. So please revisit it, send it to your friends, give them our information.
This will be my challenge for the week, how fast I can do this.
Yeah, we hope to have it up by the end of the week, but if not, I think next week. And we also have a Twitter account, so it'll definitely be posted there as soon as it's online, which is memlabnet is our Twitter handle.
I'm going to write that here, memlabnet. I can do that there.
Does it include funds for programs, promotion, printing info, et cetera? Yes, our first priority is equipment and all the needs of the lab itself. However, if there is funding left over or if that's a particular need for your institution, if that's something that you definitely won't be able to do in-house and something that's really important for the programs you want to put together, then yes, I think we can do that. For example, if you want to have like signage over your lab, which we do because it's good for people walking by to know what it is, that might be something that would be paid for with grant funding.
If you want a complete wall to call. Great.
All right. Thank you all for tuning in. We'll hang out and keep an eye on it, but we're not going to just keep running our mouths. Feel free to hang out for a minute and see if anything else occurs to you. We'll be here. Or head out. Thanks for coming, though.
And enjoy your holidays.
Yeah.
If we don't hear from you, so by next week or something.
Yeah.
Should put some music on. You're welcome. We got 18.
All right, we're not seeing any more questions, so I think we're going to cut it off here. Again, thank you all for coming, and please feel free to contact us if you think of anything in the coming weeks.
Apply.
Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.